I'm so happy you care about our election system. This is the first time ever in history that there have been so many people interested in our elections. I got involved in 2003 with Beverly Harris of Black Box Voting and helped fund the film Hacking Democracy. And since then was involved in 2004 with Audit the Vote, then working with Protect Our Elections and Brett Kimberlin and with Bob Fitrakis and Cliff Arnebeck with the Free Press and played a major role in behind the scenes in helping Obama get elected in 08 and 2012.
This is why. I don't even have to call. This is why, because on our envelope it says if somebody's changing their party. And
they're not changing their party.
But
it's a crossover ballot. See, they're not changing their party. They're still registered as no party. They're not changing their party. Because to change their party, they have to change their registration. And this is just voting. This is not registering to vote.
Okay.
I understand your confusion.
Let me make sure. Oh, wait, am I calling the right number?
Yeah, I understand that would appear to make sense to you, changing their party.
That's the difference in provision and crossover.
I think he called and did clarify for that.
This one? This one?
Yes.
The board.
When we have voters coming in and they're registered nonpartisan, and if they'd like to vote any of the four full crossover ballots, like a nonpartisan or NP Democratic or American Independent or Libertarian, they are voting provisionally or they're voting just normally? Yes. No. Like, they want to vote. Like, I have an NP voter who wants to vote NP Democratic. Yes, right. But that voter is voting provisionally, or he's voting normally? Right. But is that going in a peach provisional envelope? No? What? Right, there's four reasons, A, B, C, D, yeah. So D is, if they're changing their, I keep interrupting you. I do, and I've called the ROB, and they kept telling me that that's true, that's how we are doing it. That if somebody's voting NP, or if somebody's registered NP and they want to vote NP Dem, then we give them a NP Dem ballot, and we give them a provisional envelope.
Just today?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Until 8.
Oh, 8 p.m.?
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Okay, thank you.
And it doesn't need to go on a peach envelope.
Can't.
Oh my God. Then we've been giving a bunch of
all NP voters today. Just tell them.
We've been giving a bunch of NP Democratic. We've been getting a bunch of provisional ballots out that shouldn't be. And now they're saying the peach provisional roster. I think the ROV told me that, like, look at, if they're NP and they're voting NP Dem, that then. Right, okay, no, yeah, somebody, yeah, I get it now. Like, NP is not itself a party. NP is just, like, it was a weird gray area, I guess. Okay, so
ask what you should do about these all day.
So,
well, it doesn't matter what we've already done. We're not allowed to vote.
Yeah, no, it's, yeah. Oh, well, I mean, so these provisional votes. Yeah?
Hi, can I have your last name, please?
Right.
Hi,
How do you spell it? L-A-K-O-R-I-G-V.
I mean, oh man, that sucks. Wow, okay.
Can you request?
No. I understand, and this is, that's actually where this frustration is coming from, is because I understand what we're doing wrong now, and so, yeah, so I guess from now on, if somebody's NP and they want to vote either NP, NP Dem, American Independent, or Libertarian, then they don't get the Patron vote, they just vote normally. Okay.
3420
LaPointe Drive. And is this the
party you're going to vote today? And she's going to explain to you for that later. Could you sign here? Do you get?
Republican or? Okay.
You can vote
Those are the only four options they have to vote normally. Otherwise, they vote provisionally.
So if you can, you have.
Bob Fitrakis is going to say a few words. I've been working with Bob since 2004. He's also the editor of the freepress.org. You saw him a little bit on that movie. And we have played a role in 2008 and 2012 in making sure that Obama got elected in some very important ways. But I just want him to comment because he actually knows Michael Vu. And Michael Vu is the San Diego registrar. And he's going to say a few words. And I want to say that I have been thrilled to work with Bob all these years. He's a man of profound integrity. By the way, he knew Bernie 30 years ago. And he's a Green Party person, and he's also a professor of political science, and as I said, the writer of the freepress.org, or the producer. After we did the two programs at Sunrise Center, all of a sudden, when we talked about the election integrity lawsuit that was going to happen in Ohio, and hopefully will still happen, and I should talk a little bit about that. Can everybody hear me with this? Okay. Louder?
A little bit closer to you.
Okay. Well, like this, right? All right. Okay. Let's see. I think I'll just fill in a little space right now, actually, first talking about the lawsuit that Cliff Arnabit talked about, because many people ask us every day, when will that lawsuit be filed? And basically, it was a lawsuit that I chose to invest in the preliminaries as part of a tax-deductible donation to the Institute of Contemporary Journalism run by Bob Fitrakis. And Cliff Arnabek and Bob and I, we've been aware that exit polls have been edited to fit electronic hackable vote totals for 12 years or so. I felt that this is something that we could expose, that this happens, because a lot of people actually think that we can trust our vote. And I just want to give you my little metaphor that if I'm a politician and I want you to vote for me and I want you to write me a nice contribution check, of course I don't want you to think that something's going to happen to your vote or your money, all right? And if I'm a television program and I want those millions of dollars coming in from the Republican and Democratic parties, or if I'm newspapers also, I don't want election fraud to look like it occurs, because then I'm not going to get those millions of dollars. And if I'm an exit poll company, and exit polls are usually used in other countries to show if there's been election fraud, I'm hired by the media consortium. That's ABC, CBS, NBC, the Associated Press, MSNBC, I don't know if I remembered them all. Fox, thank you. If I'm hired by them and they give me juicy millions of dollars, you know, I want to, they get that electronic feed and I'm kind of giving people sort of a heads up on the exit polls. I kind of massage those exit polls to fit the computer vote totals. And in some cases, if I'm a registrar, I'm a government employee, I intend to be a career professional in this, and I don't want anything happening on my watch. And, you know, I'm going to defend everything to the best I can. And, by the way, oh, I just had a wonderful luncheon with the president, one of the vendors from ESNS, and, you know, we were trying to decide between ESNS and Diebold, which, by the way, is now called Dominion. And, oh, you know, he took me to, he gave us some lovely tickets to the ball game. Anyway, I have decided to choose ESNS, and, you know, that's such a nice man. I don't think anything's a problem. And I'm going to defend my choice. Okay? So I'm trying to show you the characters in the movie. And the whole thing depends upon the cycle of people's lives and how they make their money. All depend on this. And there's a big elephant in the room named election fraud. And it's getting bigger, because we have extraordinary hackable abilities now. And there are places for other countries that are going to try to change our elections too. Like the last time, China and Israel were working hard at it. They didn't succeed. But now some of our votes are counted in Barcelona, Spain, by a company called Seidel that does also on-site election reporting and things. What's that? So anyway, with that, I want to bring forward and shift gears to Bob Fitrakis, and I want you to know that it will require all of us as Americans to rise up to create a new system. But Bob Fitrakis...
This is Bob Fitrakis from Columbus, Ohio. Glad to be speaking with the election integrity people in California. We all know that nothing can ever be correct in this country if you allow what went on in California to stand. I'm teaching political science here as a political science professor. I don't allow my students to talk about the California election. At this point, we can only refer to the California California coup. Now, the most important thing going on in the nation right now is what is happening in California. I was in New York right after their election was hijacked and a coup took place with mass purges. And on the one level, there was this sort of stunned disbelief because in New York, as in California, you're not used to Ohio, Chicago-style, or even Detroit-style elections. So I know now that all of you are active, you're going forward, and you're not going to let the vote, which was stolen, and the people who were purged down, that you're going to make sure that every vote is counted. And let me apologize for Michael Vu. I came, as a free press writer, he came to our attention in 2004 when we got calls for Cleveland, and they said there's a very strange guy, supposedly a Democrat, and he's shredding ballots, and he doesn't want to count any provisional ballots. So he distinguished himself. A third of all the provisional ballots were not counted in Cleveland. And in the run-up to the election from 2000 to 2004, Mike Vu set an all-time record by purging 24.96% of every single voter in the city of Cleveland. I think the man is objectively a racist.
But one thing I got to say, because Lori did a good job in the machines. They're no good. Germany and Ireland have both banned them. And there's a reason why. It doesn't take a lot of intelligence to know why. They're not trustworthy. They are like the nuclear bomb, right? They can't be controlled. The very existence of these things tortures the entire dialogue. There's really nothing more to say except they should all be put in the town square and destroyed. You know, I'm willing to give open vote a chance, but I've got questions. Because whoever controls the votes, controls the votes. I'd like to see it as decentralized as possible. But with the lawsuits, we want a little bit of uniformity, because otherwise you've got people like Michael Vu. This is during our press conference on Tuesday. They didn't expect us to show up at 11 o'clock in the morning. It was a hot day. And there's 30 of us, and we're carrying on in the middle of it. We saw this. And before the press conference was over, they drove away. And so we sent them a notice of pending litigation, and we've asked for the name of the driver, and the name of the ledger, and the name of the this, and the name of that, and we're going to get some answers in the next week or two. Where these people are just going to get dragged up in front of the judge and be made to talk. All right, now, to wrap up, there's been three lawsuits today that I can talk about in California, and I'm going to talk about them in 2 minutes, because I think lawsuits are great, but it's nothing like the power of the people when they're aroused, all right? And what's important is for people to organize in their towns and keep working around this. It's important for people to go to Philly and keep working around this. It's important for people to take action this autumn for Jill Stein or Gary Johnson or Bernie Sanders or whoever they think is important. But the most important thing is for us to keep working together, because this is the difference. This is the difference. What we're doing, we've transformed the dialogue in this country. Even Hillary sounds like, you know, an Occupy person half the time. Well, I mean, that's what it's been. That's where the discussion has gone. I mean, it's gone from a discussion where everybody was trying to figure out how right-wing they could sound to, you know, people in Iowa saying, we think socialism is a great thing. Why isn't everybody doing it? So, with that said, the first lawsuit, I can't hear you. The first lawsuit was filed because we knew this was going to happen. That's really all it was about. We said, they're going to try to steal the votes from the NPP voters. And we told the judge, the NPP voters are being treated like second-class citizens, And you know the history of that. And he's like, I'm from Mississippi. Then I went to Harvard. No, I don't know anything about that. And we weren't terribly surprised. But we got a lot of media and got the word out before registration closed that registration was closing. And we almost taunted these people by saying, all we want, we'll drop half of our lawsuit if you'll just let us do a public service announcement and join us. Saying the two basic things, how NPP voters vote, and how you can if you can surrender your ballot at the polls and not be given a provisional. That's really all we want. They wouldn't do that. And they wouldn't do that because they didn't want to do that. Because they didn't want to admit that they had deliberately, in my mind, made life as difficult as possible for an ordinary person to vote for president in the United States. They created two ballots, and the second ballot you had to ask for. If you were no party preference, and you had to write a letter asking for it, and they told us in writing that if you don't get asked for it by mid-April, you're not going to be allowed to vote for president of the United States. And that was on a one-page letter. And then they gave us a 100-page document and said, you know, why don't you try to read this document and learn how to vote? We don't need your help learning how to vote. You need to learn how to think. You need to learn how to write, and you need to learn how to talk straight, because you have to speak with forked tongue. That is the province of the people who run these elections. There's 58 counties. They're run like fiefdoms. They're little dukes and duchesses. Again, the Republicans lean on them for this. The Democrats lean on them for that. The NPPs have no champion until Bernie Sanders came along. And now we're the voice of God saying, you can't do this. You can't live like this. We're going to make your lives utterly miserable until you straighten up. That was the first lawsuit. The second lawsuit, a little more sophisticated. And the difference in the second lawsuit is that in the second lawsuit, it was focused on one county. It was focused on this crook, Michael Vu. There's really no other word for him. And, you know, who stole ballots in 2004 and had women workers admit on camera that they had phonied up the count for the TV cameras. And these women were later convicted. And Michael slunk off to San Diego and got a new job as a registrar over there, which led to this. And he destroyed ballots in Ohio, too. Bob Fitrakis writes all about it. So, what the suit was that was filed 2 weeks ago in San Diego was very simple. It said, take the ballots, count them all. Then take the ballots that are on the machines, and then compare the two. Well, Michael couldn't do that, and a lot of other registrars can't do that either. They don't count the provisionals, they don't count all the votes. Again, they speak with forked tongue. And this is going on for 50 years. This is not new. The only difference is they've added some things to make sure the machines have a way to be tested. And it's a good statute. It's never been used. Never been used properly until now. And we are going to go to battle about this over and over again. Because this week, we filed another suit that's not going just after Vu, it's going after Padilla. And we're telling Padilla, you fucked this up in every county. You're an idiot. And you're a Hillary bot.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the way it's always been. I mean, I keep explaining to people, secretaries of state, this is what they're supposed to do. They're political animals. And that's not right. But that's the way it is. They're elected officials, they get to do whatever they want, and that includes pushing for Hillary, volubly and audibly, and as many ways as they can. And they got what they wanted. They gamed the system. When we went to court, I called them on it, and I said, your own materials train people to inform the voters. How can you live with yourself like this? And he wrote back, oh, it's okay. And the reason it's okay is because The election officials are allowed to decide how much information to give to the voters. Well, you talk to the election officials, they go, they have discretion. It's sick. It's a sick system. Okay? There's no reason anybody, Republican, Democrat, left or right, should have any time for this voting system. It is broken.
Yes.
And the only thing that will change it is people rising up. Nothing else will work. Questions? What? Some people can see it.
Because the outcome has to be certain.
Because the outcome has to be certain, and that's why we have shredders.
That wasn't Photoshop. That's exactly.
I thought it was Photoshop for a full day. It took me till 5 p.m. yesterday to believe it, and I was there at the press conference.
They were shredded right in the offices while.
No, they were shredded inside the truck.
I know. In the offices.
Well, inside the truck. That's my understanding. They take them inside the truck and they shred them in there.
But they are also shredding them. I mean, they say they shred it in front of you so you know what's been shredded. Okay? So it might have been in the offices as well. But he's doing the same thing that he did. And it was I who knew this from 2004. I'm glad I have a history in all of this. It's unpleasant as it is. But
yeah, in the back. San Diego, Registrar of Voters, 2 days ago.
In front of the register, right there.
Right.
San Diego.
So if they're shredding votes, what is the point of our even pushing for them to count them?
Well, that's a very good question. I mean, the whole point of this exercise, okay, is to say we do not live in a democracy. And we want to take it back. And anything else, as far as I'm concerned, is denial. Okay, go ahead.
Can't you have an injunction or something to stop the shredding, to stop, to make them do a recount? I mean, isn't there some way through the law?
There is. Let me address it, because that got raised at 8:30 this morning in front of a judge in San Diego. Okay? It's a mechanical exercise. I can talk more about it off mic. But the bottom line is, when you get this kind of evidence, you've got to not just show the photograph. You've got to offer context. That takes a few days. It's very, 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 very frustrating. That's why we're going to take statements and conduct depositions and that kind of thing. Because
I say we vote on football field scoreboards from now on. We see our vote and we count it that way.
And we should count it on the field, as far as I'm concerned. We shouldn't leave until the vote is counted. Well,
every high school has a scoreboard.
We've created a situation where it takes a month to do an election. In Canada, it takes a few hours because the citizens all get together with paper ballots and get it done. And I'm open to open voting, but I'm saying we need a better, more congealed society where we're willing to talk with each other and engage. Because right now, we are hopelessly alienated. Yeah.
If Alex Padilla can do anything he wants, then how is this lawsuit going to help and how is it worded?
Excellent question.
Repeat the question.
Okay, yeah, I will repeat the question. Thank you. The question is, how is this lawsuit going to help if Padilla has all this power? What are the things you're asking for in this lawsuit?
Yeah, right.
And so what we are asking for in this lawsuit, besides making Padilla stop the certification, which is no sure thing, but we got a shot because we've got some good evidence. But the other things we're asking for is we want the observers in the state of California to be honored as heroes and heroines, okay? Period. Mm-hmm. They've been out there doing the most incredible work for the last 3 or 4 weeks with nothing but scorn from these people. It's the most shameful exercise imaginable. How can they call themselves citizens and treat these citizens in this way and look them in the eye? It's hard to believe until you see what's happened in the South over the last 200 years, and then it's a little bit more understandable. These people are scared and they're running. Yeah.
Bill, going back to the shredding, what about Padilla's 22-month retention program that ballots cannot be shredded within 22 months of the final count.
Well, I'm not arguing with you, but I don't know anything about it. I don't believe anything Michael Vu has to say.
Okay.
To be honest, I just don't. But please share with us more if you've got it.
Well, it's an ROV thing. I mean, in Contra Costa, we spoke with the ROV there yesterday at length, and he said 22 months, same with San Francisco. They keep the ballots 22 months after they're counted in case something comes up.
Right, but then the question is how many ballots were originally there and who's doing the counting? I mean, this is the horror. It's the Joe Stalin problem, you know? You know, who's counting the votes here? I hate to be this cynical, but before, one more question, one thing I want to say. In Contra Costa, Padilla was reduced to having to tell the Contra Costa registrar, do not give out provisional votes to the NPP voters like candy. And you know what? They did it anyway.
Wow.
Yeah, but that's what, Padilla was under pressure, and it wasn't just from people like me. Let me try over here for a minute. Yeah.
Stop the certification. How is that going to affect the
counting?
The
convention.
Like, will the California votes not be counted, and will we be headed toward a convention where we still don't know?
I think that's exactly what's going to happen. Al Franken, for example, the senator in Minnesota, it took a year for that one to get counted. And you know why it took a year? Because the Republicans knew he was the 60th vote on the whole health care issue. And they didn't want to see that vote happen, so they held it up and held it up and held it up and made life utterly miserable for everybody in the country because they didn't want Al Franken to be the 60th vote.
How is that going to help Bernie?
Well, that's what I'm saying. Bernie and Bernie's people are what's going to help Bernie. Every time we make sure another provisional ballot is counted, it means that there should be a little redistribution towards the count for Bernie. But at the end of the day, what helps Bernie is exposing this kind of nonsense, because this is not anything unusual. I'm sorry, this has gone on repeatedly. The reason it's so hot right now is because the NPP voters have been disenfranchised and they have a champion. Yes?
A lady over there asked, if Alex Padilla, as Secretary of State, has so much power, what can you do to stop him? And I don't recall the answer.
Well, one thing you can do is do what our friend did yesterday. She went on social media with a copy of the lawsuit, got up on the stage and served him. I mean, what you need to do is you need to punch these people in the nose. That's what they understand. They understand power, okay? And I've got a word for people like this. This is war, okay? I'm a nonviolent trainer, okay? I teach nonviolence, but we have to fight. This is not for the faint-hearted.
But what is your lawsuit going to do to stop him?
What's this lawsuit going to do?
To stop him, yeah.
This lawsuit's going to do? It's going to call him out. That's what it's going to do. We're going to put forward evidence, which is not easy to do in the middle of a maelstrom where everybody's like fighting 55 different battles, okay? And saying, we got to focus, okay? We can't just be like digging each other on social media. We need to be looking for the best possible evidence and using it in a focused way. And we got anecdotes, but I don't want to repeat anecdotes. I'd like to take questions in a moment. Yes?
But can you please clarify, you said that we have to focus and we have to give you evidence that will support the case, right?
Right. What I'm looking for...
So can you clarify for everybody what kind of evidence do you need?
We can talk about that outside of here.
Okay.
But right now what we need are attorneys, investigators, and writers. And Lori always says journalists. We need journalists too. But right now, I don't care about journalists. Journalists are hired by the 1%, by and large. I know, I'm a journalist, okay? I write for reader-supported news. And we have a very humble operation. We reach hundreds of thousands of people, but we're not funded by advertising or the corporate media. But we need attorneys, investigators, and writers. We need clear thinking. We don't need conspiracy theory. We don't need to be yelling at each other. We don't need to be looking for ways to divide each other. We need to think as a movement, and we need to take 8 hours sleep and 3 meals a day and chill, okay? I'm totally serious, you know. One last thing. When somebody asks me a question on social media, and I answer the question, you know what usually happens? The same question gets asked again. And why is that? Because nobody's listening to each other, okay? We really need to take care of each other and support each other at this time. It's really, really, really important.
Yeah, I can't answer.
Yes.
I'm going to answer your question to help you out just a little bit. The magic word is recall.
Yep.
And if you go in the ghetto, if you go in the black community, there's another magic word. It's called the justice system. And Alex Padilla is a member of the justice system. Just us.
Yeah.
Just us. That's what he's thinking. Just us. Not everybody else. Just us.
But how do we recall him when he counts the votes? That's what I'm wondering. I've thought about it myself.
I think we must make the effort.
You have to keep trying. And we take away the right of the Secretary of State to do that. We have a separate system whereby the Secretary of State is not on the top of that entire voting system.
Well, having tried, I don't know if we can reduce his behavior.
You had a question?
If we can get an injunction, legally give an injunction, to keep him from certifying the vote, then that would absolutely, everything comes to a complete stop.
That's what needs to happen. We need to take a complete stop. That's what our last lawsuit is about. It's to stop him from doing that.
And then we could have a recall movement and get the man recalled. Then we could maybe even have a criminal lawsuit that would be separate.
Yes.
So there's a number of things, but it starts with the injunctions to stop the certification.
Right, but also, do not count on the justice system to do the right thing, okay? I mean, the labor movement will tell you this over and over and over again. You can seek all the injunctions or violate all the injunctions you want. That won't necessarily bring justice. You've got to think, you've got to have 3 meals a day and 8 hours sleep and meetings that last 2 hours so you can take care of your kids, okay? You need to fight and you need to think. Yeah.
Two cars wouldn't match, and so they have to go figure out where those two cars. As an observer, how do you want us to handle that if they're not going to let us watch the scrambling, they're only going to let us watch when they're going well?
Well, I think, I want to ask if the observers could come up in a moment, and like yourself and Juana, and say a few words, because I think we could learn a lot from you, quite frankly. And I mean it. And what I want to say is, all we can do in a lawsuit is we got to learn how to flex our muscles in terms of the Voter Bill of Rights. We have the right to take our cell phone and turn it on. We have the right to put video cams all over our bodies. And we have the right to march wherever we want, and if they get in our way, to sit down and not move and make the police drag us out. We are way, way too nice. I've never seen a nicer movement in my life, and I love it, okay? I love it, but there's got to be some pushback.
In Marin, the observer is no use of pagers or cell phones, cameras, or recording devices permitted in the office.
Right. That's illegal.
Failure to follow instructions should be reported. Violation of security by an observer may cause expulsion from the building or relocation by a sheriff's deputy or building security. In Marin County, where they won't let the observer look at the ballots.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. That's time for the observers to take the podium.
I just want to say that's been my experience watching votes counted in Marin. I'm at a distance. There's the back of somebody, a man usually, but anyway, the back of somebody is facing me through a glass wall, and I see a hand going like this, and that was like a waste of my time. And I agree, and thank you for bringing that out, Baba, no photographs. And that's in not just in Marin, that's in many places, and out even outside of California. And in New York, the provisional ballots, or affidavit ballots as they call them there, They decided to count only a third of them, all right? So the whole thing is profoundly corrupted. Yes.
I was hearing on Flashpoint, Bernie Sanders, a great palist, has been reporting on all the voters. He's the one that...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know Greg.
So I don't know if he would be a voice for this whole thing. He was talking about the provisional ballots, not to take them, so on and so forth. But I've never heard anything about, you know, DEA and all of this through that. So
yeah,
I don't know if
we
that
have that. Catherine Harris was the campaign manager for Bush in 2000. Ken Blackwell was the and the Secretary of State. Clinton from Florida. Ken Blackwell was the Secretary of State in Ohio and the campaign manager for Bush. And Padilla is not exactly the campaign manager, but he's an active fundraiser doing fundraisers for Hillary all over the place. And that's, by the way, he got, that's one of the, where he got served in one of his Hillary fundraisers. I do also want to let you know that Guccifer, revealed, and you've probably seen this, that there was a decision to have Hillary as the only candidate for the Democratic presidency in 2016. And there is a lawsuit that you can join as a class action lawsuit, where if you gave money, maybe that money did all went to Hillary, and you can be in the lawsuit and hopefully get some of it back. And also, this even applies to donating through Act Blue, which I did. So, you know, I just want to let you know about this lawsuit.
What is the website for that?
You just go to DNC Class Action Lawsuit. That's all you have to do.
It applies if you donated to Bernie, too.
Yeah. What?
It applies if you donated to Bernie.
Yes, I mean, they, almost all of them were, and it's against Deborah Wasserman Schultz.
Lori?
Yeah. Oh, sure, yeah.
All right. I didn't prepare anything to say, so I'm going to have to speak off the cuff. And I'm an attorney, that never happens to me. Where to start? Well, first of all, just as a general bit of experience about my background, I used to be a newspaper reporter, so I take a little bit of issue, or I used to take a little bit of issue about the press. I get it now. But, well, first I do want to say, I want to echo what Bill said. Part of this is calling people out. Never underestimate the power of embarrassment when it comes to public officials. They don't like it. All right, so I went with a group of Alameda County observers. I used to be from Alameda County. I have since moved, thank God, because what I am hearing from Alameda County is pretty awful. I went with a group of Alameda County observers to the Board of Supervisors, and I have to say that Alameda County, what I am hearing and I am seeing in Alameda County is offensive, it is obscene, it is unacceptable. And I encourage all of you to find out how much your registrar of voters is making, because Tim Dupuy in Alameda County is making a ridiculous amount of money. I don't know what his qualifications for that job are, but apparently he doesn't think he's a public official. Because you have to remember, public officials, folks, they work for us. Hello? We pay their salaries with our taxes. All right, so Tim Dupuy is walking around telling the people who are going to observe the vote, we don't have to tell you what we're doing here, right? So there's this thing in California, it's called law, or at least I used to think so. I'm a lawyer. So there's something called the Elections Code that the Registrar of Voters is supposed to follow. And there's a section, the Voting Rights Act. And if you look at California Elections Code, Section 2300, subsection 9, subsection A, subsection B, which apparently Tim Dupuy has never looked at in his entire life, nor have a lot of these registrars of voters, it says something pretty simple. Voters are allowed to observe the elections process. They are allowed to ask questions, and they're supposed to get their questions answered by somebody who knows what they're doing. You would think Tim Dupuy with his $328,000 a year in salary and benefits. Yeah. $200,000+ in base salary plus 100-something plus in benefits. A real generous, nice little government package. You would think he'd be qualified to answer our question. Well, he isn't. Okay? He tells observers in Alameda County, you can't take notes. You can't take notes. You can't talk. You can't take out your telephones. Oh, God forbid you ask questions. No, we don't tell you what happened to your votes. As far as we can tell, there was a person who released a bunch of stats, you know, based upon these numbers that were released a little bit at a time, you know, little bits and pieces. One of our statisticians tried to figure out how many votes are unaccounted for. I don't know. We don't know. It's anybody's guess. We think maybe somewhere between 28,000 and 40,000 votes are just sort of uncounted. There might be more than that. I mean, this is just what we know are either overvotes or undervotes. That's somewhere in the range of 10,000. So 10,000 or so people didn't vote for president. That's a likely scenario. And then about 27,000-ish decided not to vote for president because they voted on no party preference ballots. Yeah, that's also a likely scenario, right? I mean, right? Isn't that why everybody decided to register as a no party preference voter? Because they just, they don't care. Didn't everybody get up on election day and say, you know what I'm going to do today? I'm going to vote for Measure A. Bus bond. I just really care about that whole bunch. You know who cares? I used to be a reporter. 263 people, not 27,000. Don't tell me that. My father was a poll worker, and he was told, okay, now you're not allowed to tell anybody who they can vote for, so you're not allowed to ask anybody if they want a party preference ballot. Okay, that's not okay, all right? And according to what Bill Simpich said, well, you know, it's up to the discretion of the registrars, and apparently where I live in San Mateo County, that is not okay to ask. But, shh, don't tell anyone at all, but my father said that at his polling place in San Mateo County, where incidentally the polling machines were broken for, I don't know, 3 hours, mysteriously. I don't ask me how that happened. But anyway, they asked. Okay, that's just between us though. They asked people, would you like a ballot for one of the parties that is having a presidential election and allows you to vote? And so, you know, I told my dad, you know, that this was actually happening in another polling place because I worked as a legal observer. Incidentally, I did this for Obama, too. So I have a basis of comparison. Okay, I'm a lifelong Democrat. And you might have heard me in the video. I didn't think Democrats, you know, were behaving badly until this election. I told him, you know, hey, at this polling place that I'm observing, they're offering people a choice of ballots. Imagine that, like a menu. Which kind of ballot would you prefer? And apparently they did that at my father's polling place, and he said pretty much every single person accepted, well, actually specifically asked for, a Democratic ballot. Now, who would have thought, I mean, certainly not me, that these no party preference voters actually wanted to vote in the Democratic race? I don't know. It kind of surprises me, but apparently Alameda County is an aberration of some sort because 27,000 people decided, I'll pass. I mean, you know, and that's probably a conservative estimate because we don't really know. There's probably a bunch of provisional ballots sitting around because Tim Dupuy decided he wouldn't bother to tell us. And, you know, I have been collecting declarations from San Francisco as well, San Francisco and Alameda County, for this lawsuit that Bill is working on. And I've been hearing some pretty awful stuff. I mean, the stuff that you heard in that film is, you know, the tip of the iceberg. You know, there are ballots being dropped on the floor. I mean, this is assuming, of course, anybody can see anything. You know, there are a lot of irregularities to the extent that anybody can see anything. But there are also, you know, well, in San Francisco, they had a dog and pony show when I went up to observe of, hey, look at us, aren't we cute? Look at this, we're gonna show you around, Ms. Bain. Look, we have people here, and they are counting votes, and nobody is shredding anything. I guess I didn't get lucky, like my colleague there. Nobody was shredding votes the day I showed up. Yeah. But they didn't do that. Nothing that obvious, nothing untoward. But apparently, more people wanted to see for themselves that nothing untoward was going on. So they kept going back. And they kept moving the observers further and further and further and further away. And one day, our observers started taking notes. They were kept 10, 20, up to 29 feet away. So I wrote to Deputy City Attorney Josh White in San Francisco. I said, you know, our observers can't see anything. And he ignored me after a while. He pretended to be nice. After a while, he finally said, you know what? They can see. As far as I'm concerned, this is a public observation process. As far as I'm concerned, we are complying with the law. So these elections officials are basically saying, dear Californians, we are giving you the giant collective finger. That is a violation of our rights as citizens. And as Bill said, we need to fight back, okay? We have a right to know what happened to our votes. And in California, we don't know. In most counties, they won't tell us. They didn't let us watch. It's bad enough that these poll workers that talked in this video had no idea what they were doing, most of them, all right? No disrespect intended, I've been a poll worker, but then nobody let us find out what happened after the fact either. In many counties, San Diego is a particularly egregious county, Alameda is a particularly egregious county, San Francisco is not far behind them. It's kind of horrifying that a lot of this is happening in the Bay Area, where I thought, you know, we are a progressive, wonderful place. I was wrong. This is embarrassing.
We were all for Bernie. Why wouldn't it happen?
Yeah, Bernie.
It would happen the worst here. Yeah.
That's a good point.
That's a really good point. You know, I come from a background of really genuinely believing that people try to do the right thing. And if they're doing the right thing, if people are just being paranoid, then let us see. Let us see what happened to the votes. There are a lot of votes that we can't figure out what happened to them. Let's find out. Where are they? How are they being counted? And why are there different standards being applied in different counties? So one of the things that's happening is we are starting to do public records requests. How are these people being trained to count the votes? Is it different in different counties? I'm highly suspecting so. And how are they going to respond to these public records requests? Let's find out. So if there are any other observers who want to speak, I'd like to hear from them. Thanks.
Know how many votes were spoiled, and my question is about spoiled ballots. One of the things I wanted to know is, you vote, you know, your president, your secretary, whatever, all the way down to your supervisors and different questions, you know, and some of them it's fill in one box, some of it's fill in two. If it says fill in two of four and you fill in four, is that makes it a void vote?
It should not make the entire ballot void. No.
Okay, that was my question.
Okay, I was an inspector in Sonoma County, and a spoiled ballot is a ballot that you're in the voting booth and you marked it wrong, and you realize, oh my God, I marked this wrong. Mm. And so you walk up to the inspector, their clerk, and you say, I made a mistake. and the clerk says, okay, fine, we're going to rewrite spoiled ballot on that, and we give you a fresh new ballot, and the spoiled ballots go in a little envelope or pocket by themselves. Spoiled ballots are just ballots that people requested. They made a mistake. They want to fix it. They're given a fresh ballot. There's nothing untoward about a spoiled ballot. That's a non-issue.
Yes. Well, in the Brexit vote, there were 9,000 people, and they only had two boxes to mark. And of 9,000 people, they marked both boxes. So I want to know if, what it is that people can do that messes up their vote.
I very seriously doubt that happened in the presidential election. If it did, it would only, I imagine, apply for something where there are multiple candidates you're supposed to mark, and you accidentally vote for more than one of those. And that should not invalidate a presidential candidate vote.
Yeah, if you marked it wrong, and say for senators, they would have to ignore your senator vote. But if you marked it for Bernie or Hillary, whatever, and then they would not discount that part of the ballot. That part of the ballot should remain valid.
These are things that should be in the training materials for the people counting the votes.
There's also the situation, I've been reading countless, can I be at mic? Do a little
mic.
Okay.
Down in LA,
there were machines that there were some people who just really wanted to vote for president, and any time that they slipped the ballot in the scanner, it clicked up error message. And what they needed to do was to choose another person in the down ticket, even if they didn't know them. But the poll worker that was complaining about this felt that you shouldn't have to do this. If you just want to vote for president, go vote for president. But the machine was spitting it out, saying error.
That's wrong.
Well, I'm the best. Tell the machine.
The thing is, we need to outlaw machines. There should be no machine voting.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
Anyway. I agree.
I've been an observer for the I've been an observer for the last 2 weeks, and I'm observing specifically ROV's San Bernardino, and what I do is I'm very close and upfront. I have over 80 pages just of notes. It's very important for me to be very meticulous, and so I do ask for the procedures to see what it is that they're doing, and I have the actual guidelines. So when someone, Dave happens to be the GIS manager, instructing his workers what it is that they need to do, I'm right there on the same page, and I'm also looking at the group specifically one by one, an hour each at a time, taking notes to see what it is that they're doing. And I'm new too. I have no idea what's going on when I go in there. I'm trying to ask all these questions that you guys ask in there, and I get information like this. It doesn't come easily. I have to ask. I've also done the CEPRA. I've done 3 different requests. Slowly they've come in. I consistently say, I cannot follow along. What is that candidate that is supposed to be the write-in, what is valid? Is Pee Wee Herman valid? Will you be counting that? Where can I find that information? Oh, it's online. Can you show me? My phone is right here. And so if they don't give me that information, I go ahead and I print it out. And it's a lot of information that I've been given in that way. Just very, very persistent, consistently, time and time again. I do use them to my benefit, the escorts that are there, and I ask them questions. And yes, as the election has gone closer, towards the end, I've been pushed back that, oh, you can't go there. This is not information that is accessible that has to do with the election, so you shouldn't be there. And I'll say, well, why is that? And I have it in recording, so I always walk in with a recorder. I just walk in. And that's what I do as a university student. I record all my classes. I just have that habit. So everything that we speak or we talk about, I take consistent notes, and I have recordings of every single one of them, so it's been for the last 2 weeks. And I also have a folder that I've been compiling. What is a provisional ballot? What does it mean to be a minor? What does it mean? Like, so much information that you're able to attain in that portion that you feel overwhelmed. And a lot of this thing, I said, well, I need a visual, because sometimes auditory is not enough for me. So I have a collection of things What is a provisional ballot? What does it look like? Why will you have to be voting on a provisional ballot? Maybe you're not from the county. Maybe, you know, you moved. Maybe you already voted at a polling place. Maybe you're not at the right precinct. Perhaps you're not registered. Or maybe you're an NPP and you were given a Democratic ballot and your ballot's gonna be duplicated. And if it's duplicated, it's probably gonna be duplicated either as an NXD, which is a crossover, and not as a Democratic, because they're not considering to take the president as a contest. And all these things are called contests, by the way. So this is very new, and it's like a new language that I'm learning. And it's very obfuscating, and it's very difficult to understand at times. So I get a lot of visual materials, and I follow this step by step. It's like I'm my own recorder visually, but all the paperwork that I have, kind of, I can show you guys and say, look, here's what I've done, here's what I've seen. And I can help a lot of you at least understand into the process. Why is it that a lot of the things that are occurring is we don't have that knowledge, and we don't know what's happening. And yes, there are a lot of ballots that won't be counted, and it's because they're not registered. They go through three different checks. I'm always a visual, so if I can bring my provisional ballot and show you what I'm talking about, would you guys mind?
No, please. Did you have to vote provisionally?
Excuse me?
Did you have to vote provisionally? No?
No.
Okay.
I have my ballot still here, and I asked for a crossover.
You asked for a crossover and you were given one, right?
Yes, yes.
Great.
Yes,
I
can I just ask a quick question? Because I'm going to have to leave pretty soon.
Yeah.
My rights, so I have to go. You know, on those updates that we see on Facebook of how the election's going, how Bernie's doing in comparison with Hillary?
Right.
How do we know those are accurate?
I'd like to say something to this. Okay. First of all, many votes have not been counted. There's also something that's happening where there's 1% recounts and manual tallies, which are supposedly for showing if the machines worked. But they're doing 1% manual tallies when there are both vote by mails that need to be still counted, and there are provisional ballots. And that's one of the things we're challenging, because the definition is a 1% random count. And random means usually surprise. You don't know what ahead of time. But when people count ballots, when they do a random count, when not all the ballots have been counted, a 1% count, it's actually a contradiction to the word random. And this has been happening in different places, and that's another part of the lawsuit.
Ask, is there going to be like an army of Marines at all of the polling places in November so that we can monitor it as it's happening instead of after the fact?
There isn't a plan for that. I do have to say that I'm delighted that Marie's been able to get some cooperation. It's taken a lot of persistence for her. What I experienced was more the pushback that this lady here talked about. And I want to say something on a personal level as opposed to representing my nonprofit, that it would need to have some of you at least going to Philadelphia, taking a stand for this travesty of our election that should have been a Bernie landslide in California. And I myself am also, as much as I don't emphasize it in these presentations, I also was a Bernie supporter. And concern that I recently learned about was the possible releasing of lots of Bernie people in the streets, building the fence around, or a wall around the convention center. There's a possibility of opening a prison, for angry Bernie protesters.
That's
what the Republicans did that in the New York one, the last presidential. I'm not done yet. And also the release of provocateurs. And provocateurs will be people who will, either have a sound gun at a
a Bernie voter or a pepper spray or this, and then the media take pictures of the angry Bernie person. And then that goes on the headlines of the newspaper. So I'm telling you, you need to watch this, and I've been exploring trying to get a chill space for people who care about Bernie, because if you're going to be attacked and taunted into being reactive, you need a place to relax and cool out. And you know, so anyway, we're looking at that, and that's separate from my institute. But yeah, and well, we need to hear from Joan Paul now. So if it's quick, what? You're right. This is the groundswell for protecting ourselves. I repeat.
Something like this gets transmitted to the other states, so the military may not be the answer. So what happens here? It doesn't happen in November, because our picture is way bigger, and you guys have started it. How do we plan for that?
This is it.
I personally think we have to keep on informing. We have to keep on Facebooking people, and we have to keep on, go to TrustVote.org, we'll keep updated on what's possible.
Yes.
And it's a serious question, and all of us will have to figure out where we can contribute. By the way, we are looking at open source strategies where you can vote and record what vote you took. You record your vote with a numbering system in open source, which will be available to some people, and that we're presenting on that in the second week in July.
But it's not secure. I've talked to that guy. It's not secure.
It depends which system you're talking to. But anyway, I'm just saying we're looking at the future in the second week of July. So, and I'm open to more than one system, and I don't know which guy you talked to. So, We have our last presenter.
All right.
Outside of
Emily. Okay. So why don't you introduce him?
Okay, so John Paul Rice is somebody who's has been actually a Bernie supporter and done a great deal of analysis of our election, both nationally and in California. And he has also done statistical research, which won't be discussed in this particular event because it's still being worked on, but it shows that there's been most likely electronic voting machine fraud and tabulator fraud. And then he's also going to take a bigger picture look at Bernie and has put together a little PowerPoint for us. So,
all right, John.
All right, thank you very much for the introduction. Ed, can you go ahead and put up the PowerPoint for me, please?
Yes, we're looking at People Vote With There.
Yes, okay. So just before I start into this, I want to thank everybody for giving me the opportunity to speak to you tonight and also to share a little bit of information, what I can right now, and maybe just kind of tell you a little bit about myself and my background. I am by trade a business systems analyst. That means I do requirements, I do deep analysis and thought in my profession. I deal with numbers and math and code. And I also, ironically enough, I'm in California and I am an independent filmmaker. I make feature films that deal with social issues. And some of the films that I've discussed and touched upon have to deal with homelessness, domestic violence, child abuse, and most recently, mental illness. And these are many of the stories that we work on at the company I am president of, deal with real life stories based on true stories of people that I've known, research that I've done, and people that inspire in spite of enormous obstacles. So that's kind of what I do. And what I want to share with you tonight is what my goal is in achieving and talking to each and every one of you, or those who are listening on the internet as well, is to bring awareness to observation, and also to talk about a little bit about action, which is goes beyond activism. But want to just kind of walk back in time a little bit to how I became involved in this year's election. I've been politically active before, I guess you could say, not as an activist, but I've participated. I registered to vote when, you know, I was of age, and I was raised in the South, and I used to vote very conservative, as many people did. And when I moved to California several years ago, I started to have a lot of my ideas that were challenged, a lot of my conservative ideas, not from necessarily a political ideology, but just my understanding about how the way the world worked. And in short, coming up to this summer, I was aware that, you know, who the nominees were going to be. Of course, the press usually does their wonderful job in the last year of a presidency to let you know who the candidates are, and let you know who the front runners are and where they're polling long before anything ever happens. And so I caught a video on YouTube last July, I think it was, of this white-haired 74-year-old man speaking in a crowded auditorium of 10,000 people in Wisconsin, in some impassioned speech that I have never heard anybody speak quite that way ever, especially a politician. And I started following the campaign. I started following politics a little bit more closely than I ever have been before. And the issues that were being raised are some of the issues that I would say indirectly are addressed in our movies. It's done with a sense of compassion. It's done with a sense of awareness and care. And so there were a lot of issues that were being discussed this election cycle that spoke to some of the values that I feel. But that's not politics. What is important, and I guess the way that I have seen, and based on my observation of watching rally after, is involved in different things. We go to church, some of us do, some of us don't. We spend our time where we want to be. And so if you can go to the next slide, Ed, yes. We're just going to talk about money for a second. There was an unprecedented amount of money raised in the Democratic primary by two candidates. Obviously, there were issues that were addressed in terms of where funds came from. And what really spoke about this entire election season was the power of fundraising at a grassroots level. I'd like to go to the next slide.
Okay.
This is the total amount raised from individuals who gave $200 or less to the two campaigns. This data comes from the Federal Election Commission. This is where they do all the monthly filings. Senator Sanders raised $195 million from people who gave $200 or less. It is my understanding, as early as I think the day before the June 7th California election, that one-fourth of all of his donations came from people who were unemployed or disabled or who make less than the median income. And Secretary Clinton raised $97 million of $200 or less. The total campaign, that came about approximately 38 to 39% of her total fundraising. This is separate from super PACs. This is working people who are donating whatever they can, some giving the maximum contribution, obviously $2,700 or more bundles. But what I will tell you that's not on this page is that in 2016, Senator Sanders raised approximately, and it could be a little bit more, but approximately out-fundraised Hillary Clinton by over $40 million. The difference between where they get their sources of money in this particular statistic is about $98 million, $98.5 million. Ed, if you go to the next slide.
It's up.
Okay, donations by size, you can kind of see it almost swings from left to right. And you see the small contributions. This is from a site called CrowdPack, which is not an independent analysis. This is actually sourced from the Federal Election Commission. They just did their own chart here to show what they consider small, medium, and large, and the percentages of each. And again, this is non-super PAC money. Next slide, please.
Yes.
We're going to talk a little bit about campaign money. And the reason for this is specifically about campaigns. When you run a campaign, obviously you have to have a base of support. And that base of support, generally, you know, if they believe you're the person, you feel maybe to donate, maybe to contribute, maybe to do whatever kind of support, if it's a bumper sticker or sending $5. But I wanted to look at the historical part of the comparisons between 2008 and 2016, specifically for Hillary Clinton's campaign, because it was of an interest to me, and this is something that I stumbled across, and I wanted to, you know, let you know that OpenSecrets.org is a nonpartisan outfit. This is right off their Wikipedia page and their website. They have followed campaigns for years. It actually came about from a Republican and a Democrat who both wanted full disclosure about donors and the services and the industries and the geography and the full breakdown of where this money comes from. So Open Secrets had Hillary Clinton's 2008 fundraising on it, and I want to show you in the next slide there what I saw.
Okay.
Total dollars from donors who gave $200 or more in 2008. You can see that there was $131 million. And in 2016, there was $109 million. That was as of the end of April. So those numbers could have changed just a slight bit, but they were definitely down by $22 million less than in 2008. And the number of donors who gave $200 or more, this was probably the most significant number to me, was the fact that as a net loss, and that includes a shift in 2016 where she actually gained more high net worth donors, the people who gave the $2,700 as well as the George Clooney fundraisers of $350,000 bundles for a table. She has 28,484 fewer donors than in 2008. By those statistics, she has run a much weaker campaign from a base of people who support her as well as vote for her. And that's not to say that she doesn't have the support out there. It's just striking to me when thinking about 2008, and I could go into the numbers there, where she was running an extremely competitive race against Barack Obama and barely lost that race. And in a Democratic primary that was competitive to the very end, in this particular case this year, she raised less from the public, and the majority of her money in this particular election cycle was from high net worth donors as well as super PAC money. Obviously, that's independent from the campaign, but it was quite interesting to see such a significant drop when in 2008 she ran highly competitive, and in 2016 she ran a more highly competitive campaign with less. If you can go to the next slide.
Yes.
Crowds at rallies. Now, this is one of the things that was, for me as a social media junkie that I am in some respects, I had a really fun time looking up, you know, people's Snapchats and Twitter and Instagrams where they were at the rallies for both Secretary Clinton and Bernie Sanders. And what you found was, historically, I went back and I looked at her largest crowd to date was the launch of her campaign in New York City on Roosevelt Island. The first public rally, she had 5,500 people there, June of last year. Sanders' largest crowd to date was 30,000 plus in Oakland. Now, I know that the police department, there were reports that said there were 60,000 people there in the overflow, but I wasn't able to put this on a slide, but I do want to tell you that just of observation. I watched, I'm from the South, and so I watched one of the states in the South where I'm from, it's sort of closer to the Midwest on the Mason-Dixon line. I saw Senator Sanders travel the entire state, know all the places that he went to, even have dated a few people in that area of the country. And minimum drawing 2,000, 3,000, 7,000, and up to 15 and 20,000 in the state of Kentucky, which was really interesting to me because I have spent about 10 years of my life there, and I can tell you that Louisville, Kentucky is as progressive, it even has a slogan called Keep Louisville Weird. It's as progressive in the South as you can get to Portland, Oregon. He drew on the date of his speech there on the riverfront, I think 7,000 or 8,000 people. And all over the state that he went, he drew thousands every single day. But the most significant factor about Louisville, or excuse me, Kentucky as a whole, is the 2 months leading up to the primary on May 17th, was that he had out-fundraised Secretary Clinton and all of the GOP field combined for 2 months in the state of Kentucky. That was sourced off of a local paper. And I have also been finding that in other states, the social media probably was the best source to get nuggets of information and try to go and verify them. But in states like Michigan, it was a record turnout that day. Now, granted, the Republicans also voted on the same day, but nonetheless, it was the highest turnout for Michigan since 1980. It was the highest turnout in Wisconsin, close to the highest turnout in Wisconsin ever since 1972. Idaho broke all records for U.S. caucuses with its turnout. And if you go online and look at some of the photos that day, some of the gymnasiums were so full, they had to count people outside. Those are the things that I'm not going to say are an indicator, per se, of somebody who's winning. But I caution the use of this only because there is a counter-narrative out there that says, well, you know, Bernie Sanders, people draw the big crowds, we bring the voters. And I would ask the question, and I just want to raise this as an issue to anybody who believes that, which they're welcome and entitled to, but if I were to compare side by side, as I just have, and then I were to tell you candidate A has been drawing 5,000, 10,000, 15,000, 20,000, 25,000, 30,000 plus everywhere he goes in the country, is out fundraising his opponent 4 months in a row of an average of $5 to $20 million per month, is out pulling the GOP and every candidate for the last 2 months by an average of 10 and 15 points or higher in some cases on a national level, has the highest favorables of any candidate in the race, and also has the highest trustworthiness of any candidate in the race, which are two key indicators any political pundit will tell you determines electability. When you put all those factors together and you put them against candidate B, who has small crowds, less fundraising than they did in a competitive race in 2008, and has a less visible presence, let me just say that, across the board with people in general, who would you believe is winning? I mean, let me put it another way for a pop crowd, pop culture. If Adele, Taylor Swift, or Drake announced that they were coming to your city with less than 24 hours notice, and you walked into that arena that night, and the entire arena is full of people, and somebody from the 1990s, Hootie and the Blowfish, no offense to them, I used to own their albums, but Hootie and the Blowfish, who've been around for about 25 years, show up at the local coffee shop and draw 500, who do you believe has more fans? Who do you believe has more album sales? Who do you believe is leading in the charts? So I guess what I want to say is that if you are to believe this is possible and real, there is a bigger picture here, because we all can know this, but it's either, you know, don't believe your lying eyes, or people really do vote with their feet, time, and money. What I wanted to do in my example of this is to kind of segue into something that is really important. And Ed, if you can go to the last slide for me.
Okay, you got it.
All right. Bernie Sanders recently announced, I think it was a couple of weeks ago when he did his online stream, to announce the new, you know, what movement forward in the campaign. And he talked about people becoming politically involved in the process. And I think some 10,000 people signed up that night to run for local positions, school councils, boards, this, that, and the other. But what I wanted to tell you is that when he went down the list of all the things that had been done, the hundreds of thousands of unpaid volunteers, the $5 million door knocks, the 75 million phone calls that were made, the 74,000 volunteer meetings, the 2.5 million donors, and the over 8 million contributions. And we have been taught that, you know, math and facts matter. And I want to give you something that is really far bigger than that. We've also been taught that there are winners and losers in life, and that those winners and losers, that when you lose, you go home, right? They do that all the time in sports, you know, win or go home. And I would argue that in many ways, we have won a massive victory, not just because what we did with all of that goodwill and that money and that time that we spent hours waiting in line, or donating, or volunteering, or phone banking, or telling our family about somebody that we believed in, is that we proved, we have an actual case study that proves there is a model on how to run an ethical election. It's not some idea, it's not some theory that exists in a vacuum. You've actually done that for one person who says it's all about you. And if we have that kind of will and momentum in us to organize and to think about what is most critical and important, and he says this very clearly to everyone, election days come and go. It's not rhetoric, guys. Everything that he has been saying for 25 years has either come true or is becoming realized. He was speaking 25 years ago to an empty chamber in the House, railing against the Iraq War, the first Gulf War, and no one listened. And you have somebody that has, for decades, done that day in and day out, not giving up. And I would offer this as a sort of sobering reality of what we're faced with, is not an election cycle where if it doesn't turn out how we want it to be or what we think it should be, and if it's even not right, what I will say to you is this: if you give up, if you stop spreading that message, it will be over and we will go home and we will lose. And the consequences of that are far greater. And why I say that is this: all the evidence that I have looked at and read about, and some of the most horrifying things about climate change that I have read, I don't recommend doing it late at night. There is an article, and I will tell you what it is right now. You just look it up. It's called A Degree by Degree Warming of the Earth. And it goes 1 degree Celsius, 2 degree, all the way up to 6. And at 6, historically, everything in our entire record of history at 6 degrees Celsius is an extinction level event of 95 to 99% of all the species on the planet. And why I say this is the point. I ask people to not think of themselves as a political ideology, which you only identify yourself with and nothing else. And the reason I say that is this. When I looked at the last data poll that Vox Media, which is Eric Klein, I think it's Edric Klein, formerly with the Washington Post, he started his own media outlet, and when the race was called, he did a poll of over 1,000 people. And the poll was, do you want Senator Sanders to drop out? An overwhelming majority of all the people said no. Democrats, independents, Republicans, and you know who he had the biggest support from? The Tea Party.
Wow.
And the reason why, this is my belief as to why I've met a few people in that camp. They're not Trump supporters. They were co-opted in 2010 with Dick Armey using an AstroTurf campaign to take white middle American outrage, the independents who had been neglected by both parties, the Democrats, the corporate Democrats, and the corporatist Republicans, as a means to counter all of the things that they were angry about. And all they did was use that to get the most right-wing and extreme House of Republicans elected, and some senators as well. They left them behind. They found and saw that they were just in on the take, just like everybody else was, and nothing changed, and nothing happened. And they actually are at a place right now where only the person who is most honest that they can trust, according to how they feel, is the answer. And I would argue, I offer this because this November, no matter what happens at the convention, before the convention, after the convention, we have to continue to move forward working together, not against each other. This isn't about my team winning, your team losing. This opportunity is coming to a head, and it will be up to who is the majority that reaches out to the other side. And when I say the other side, the political divide, but find common ground, not politically. The number one issue is to get big money out of politics, get in public funding. We can get that out of our politics. We have an opportunity to talk about the issues and debate how we go from here. But until that happens, what you think, what I think is right, is not going to happen because the money is what will dominate it all. And the truth is that there is case study to prove that this can happen. If you look back, not just 15 years ago, with the advent of Napster. Now, it was a disruptive technology that pirated music.
So, John, we've got to go. Yeah. We've got to close.
Okay.
It's been a long time. Thank you, John. So I really appreciate those of you who've been able to last as long as you have. And Netra here is going as a delegate to the convention, Bernie delegate in summer, and is going as Journey for Bernie, right? And they'll be available. You can come right up to them and ask questions or interface. And again, I want to thank all of you. As I'm packing up, you can, and Emily, come forward.
I'm Emily Levy, and I put together the handout that hopefully you were given when you came in this evening. That's what you can do to get involved in the struggle for integrity of our elections. And I was going to speak for longer, but clearly the moment has passed. But if you're interested in getting involved, I'll be here for a few minutes, and you can come talk to me. And also, the handout will be posted on your website as well, right? For people who are watching online, TrustVote.org.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you, Emily. It's been a long night. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming and staying.
Thank you, everybody, for your persistence. One of the things that was talked about.